Our next storyteller signed up for this class on a dare, and she regrets it, but she's been amazing. She's also a veteran. Please welcome up to the stage, Jenny Hoskin.
You know how they say, when you're looking for love, you won't find it, and if you want love, you need to stop looking? Who are they, right? In my case, they were the people who had way too much input about what I was doing in my personal time after I got divorced. So I was out of the Marine Corps, I was single, I jumped on Match.com, and after a year, I got an email from Match.com that said I was unmatchable, and keeping with their corporate standards or their commercials, I got my money back. Great. That's cool. I just kept working. Not really looking for love, just, you know, I worked a lot. My boss in the audience. A few months go by, maybe later that summer, I signed up for eHarmony because they had cool commercials. And like, eHarmony was quicker. 3 months into it, eHarmony sent me an email with tips on how to make my profile a little churchier. And it occurred to me that eHarmony was a Christian dating profile because apparently I didn't watch the whole commercial. And I wrote back, and I thought it was funny, but I said, of all the people on the planet to add some more Jesus to their dating profiles, not it. So I keep working, and that's fine, and traveling a little bit, and I get an email one day, and it's from an old coworker, and there's about 10 guys on the two line, and I don't even read the two line, right? It's just a bunch of Marines, because I was in the Marine Corps, all my friends are Marines, and it's a funny email, and I'm a funny guy, and I reply all with some funny, and I get an email back, and it's from a name I don't know. And I look at the name and I think I've offended somebody. And I open the email and all it says is, "You're a funny fucker." Hey, I'm a funny guy. So we start talking and we go back into the group chat and then we talk offline and we talk and we talk. And before you know it, I'm madly in love with somebody I've never met. We've exchanged 30,414 emails. I know that because Google reminds me. That's a lot of email. So, for the better part of a year, we don't get to meet. He's working, he's active duty, I'm working. We Skype, we have Sunday dates, because how cheesy is that, right? Like, okay, press play at the same time and we'll watch a movie together. You're cheering for that. But it's great, we really get to know each other. I'm a photographer, we send each other a lot of photos. Not just those kind of photos. He's this big tattooed combat veteran and he's sending me photos of a flower. Because I send those flowers, because I like flowers. So over the course of next year, we get to know each other, and we have a chance to be in the same city at the same time, and it's Kentucky, just random, you know, no town in Kentucky. And we meet up there, and you would think, right, this is crazy, this is a Craigslist combat, this is a movie, you know. No, it was amazing. I met him at the airport, it was like we've known each other our whole life. I spent the next 4 days getting to know all of his tattoos, a lot of tattoos. I'm from the city, he's from the mountains. One of the things we talked about was getting lost, you know, just find a country road and drive. And to his credit, we did. We found a bridge, we made it ours. We spent just so much time in 4 days. I felt like we lived a lifetime in 4 days. He went back to his base and I went back to mine. And later that year, we had a chance to meet up again. And the tone's a little bit different. The conversations haven't stopped. We go rock climbing and I noticed something is different and I'm not sure what it is, and then it comes out. He's having some problems with his ex-wife and there's some custody stuff. And he says to me, we've been together for 10 days and then we go back to our separate corners and our separate bases. And he says, we're gonna do some family therapy and work out the custody thing. And I was really offended by the family part of that because we were talking about buying property. We could have been on a farm and I wasn't part of the family part of that. And so I said, hey, let's take a break. This is a good time for a break. Not break up, but a break. Like, I love you, I'm gonna love you forever, but let's take a break. Let me take myself off your plate while you work through the family stuff. And this conversation gets ugly and cry a lot and hate, you know, and so we decide, okay, we'll take a break, he'll do some counseling. Maybe I'll just go rock climbing. He asked me right before I got off the phone, he asked, would you do this again? Like if you met me the same way and you knew there was the baby mama drama, I hate baby mama drama. If you knew there was a drama, would you fall in love with me again? No, man, who picks to fall in love with drama? Like, I love you and I'm always gonna love you and we'll be together forever, but probably would have picked it. So He goes to his separate corner, I go to mine. I say that because he listens to very dark music when he's upset, and I listen to very bright music when I'm upset. And my phone rings all night, and I ignore it. On a break. Haven't you seen Friends? This is a break. I'm not doing anything but laying in bed, looking at the phone, hoping he'll text her, right? And I'm listening to The Exercise All Out of Love. I know I said bright music, but you'd stop and listen to that song, right? So I fall asleep, and I wake up to some missed text messages and several calls. And then later that day, and I don't respond to any of them. Want a break. Friends, right? So later that day, a good friend of mine calls and says, hey, I don't know if you got the news, but he killed himself last night. And my first thought is, hey, fucker, want a break. Like, not dead. Want a break. So I'm really angry, and it's all about me. And I think of all the things that I said the night before that I shouldn't have, or, you know, all the things that I didn't say that I could have, and I spend the next year just, nah. And part of what I do to cope with my emotions is I write a lot. I write good. So one day I sit down and I've got time, I just pour it all out. My sorry, my anger, my sorrow, my disappointment, my loneliness, and it is quickly 25 single-spaced pages in a far-long notebook. So what do I do with that, right? I rip it out of the notebook, and I get on a plane to Kentucky, and I rent the car, and I go looking for that bridge. Because I didn't get to go to the funeral, I didn't get to say goodbye. I really wanted to be done being angry. So I rent this car, and I'm driving, and I'm totally lost. I mean, I get lost in a phone booth. I can step into a phone booth, make a call, and not know which was the door. I get lost. So I'm driving down this country road, it's raining, my GPS says, you're lost. And I look down, my GPS actually says, no signal, good luck. And I'm crying so hard that I can't see. Like, my mascara is mingled with my chapstick. So I just pull into a side road. And I know in Kentucky, side roads are driveways. And I know in Kentucky, if it's posted no trespassing, you can be shot. But I didn't care. I couldn't drive. So I pull over and pull it. 25 loosely pages, and I'm looking through them, and I'm piercing, and I'm snotty and angry, and throwing them. And all of a sudden, I look up, and there's a farmer tapping on the window of this rental car. And I swear to God, my first thought was, I could leave. I could outrun this old man. And I go. I gather up my 25 pages, and I get out of the car, and he says, are you okay? And I just look at him, and I start to explain, before you know it, I'm getting angry, break. No. So he steps back and he pulls a Kleenex out of his pocket. It's actually a white linen, what do you call it, a kerchief. He pulls a kerchief out of his pocket and he hands it to me, and I promptly defile it. It's like the softest thing I've felt in a week. And I just all over this thing. And I don't do this, but he's pulled out his flip phone in this time. And while I'm finishing defiling his nice linen Kleenex, he must have called his wife, because he stands there and he sort of has his hand out, and I think he's asking for his Kleenex back. So I fold it in half and hand it back to him, because, you know, I'm classy. And without missing a beat, he slides it into his pocket, and then he holds out his other hand, and I'm thinking, I only have one Kleenex, old man. And it's his wife, and his wife walked up with a box of Kleenex, a map, and a glass of sweet tea with mint leaves in it. And so he says to me, I can help you find that bridge, and you won't, and you can go back there, and you can throw your pages off in the water, and nobody will know, but I reckon your loved one, he'd just as soon read that letter if he bury it here at the bottom of that tree as he would if he threw it off that bridge. You want to know what I think? No. I just don't want to be shot for trespassing. He says, I think your fellow was sicker than you knew, and I think no matter what you'd have said or done, you weren't going to be able to save him. And I think sometimes that just happens, and I think you came all the way back here to go back to that bridge. But young lady, I think you need to move on. So what do you want to do? I'm thinking, I want the recipe for your sweet tea. And I said, I'll bury the letter, sir. And so he produces a shovel from whence I don't know. And they hand me the shovel, and he tells me to leave the glass on the fence post. And I spend some time crying, and I dig a hole at the bottom of a tree in a farmer's field somewhere in Kentucky. And I have my goodbye. I have my funeral. I have my I'm sorry. I get some absolution. And I stand up, and I'm ready to leave. And I everything I can out of that glass of sweet tea, and there's mint leaves in it. I think that was the catch. But as I walk over and I set the glass on the fence post, all I can think of is, I'm never gonna find this tree again. So like, this needs to be my goodbye. So I take a minute and I say goodbye. And I'll tell you, to this day, I still can't drink sweet tea without mint leaves in it.